All right, hello, fun, and welcome back to Cutabo Space Program, where today we are having a look at the Gary Anderson Space 1999 pack, which is being released by Skunkworks Command. And what this glorious little piece of work looks to add into the game is a pretty decent number of parts to build the various spacecraft and even launch pads from the Space 1999 series, a sci-fi classic. So let's jump into the space plane hangar and have a look at what we do get here. And let's start by grabbing ourselves a Mark 1 inline cockpit for size comparison's sake, and then head to our mod filter, just leaving on Eagle 1. And we'll have a look at our first part here, probably for the most iconic ship of the series, and that is the Eagle 1 transporter cockpit, which can hold two Kerbals. It actually does require a minimum of two Kerbals to successfully operate. It does also have a built-in generator, reaction wheel, SAS, and a 50 electric charge for you to use. And all in all, if we chuck this thing onto there, is a pretty good looking little craft. And very much does match, of course, with the look and feel of the one from the series. Sadly, it does not have an internal view here, but hopefully that may be added in the future. I would very much like to see that. But overall, just a lot of great detail to this thing. Got the Alpha Moon base there and all. Oh, I love that show. And so happy to see another mod adding in something like this into the game, because we actually have looked at some similar mods to this in the past. Now let's take a look at the next cockpit that we do have, and that one is, of course, for the Hawk Interceptor cockpit. Now, once again, this one will hold two Kerbals and does require two Kerbals to operate. It has that generator, reaction wheel, SAS, and once again, 50 electric charge. So you're gonna get the same stats out of this thing, but as you can see, it's a bit different of a cockpit, being all cool and orange, and with a few slight different details here and there. But overall, still a fun, good cockpit. And I mean, come on, who doesn't like the Hawk Interceptor? That thing was awesome. Now, after that, we have a number of, the transport pods up here as well, which go along with the Eagle 1 transporter once you have the rest of the frame built for it. And the first one of these will have a gander at, if I can actually properly chuck that thing off, is, of course, the Eagle 1 transporter basic pod, which this one does have the capacity to hold up to 8 Kerbals, does have a built-in alternator, it does have a command pod function requiring 2 to operate, has a built-in docking node, engines providing a thrust of upwards of 2,500 kilonewtons, using liquid fuel and oxidizer with 2 degrees of gimbling, also does have reaction wheel, SAS, and a 50 electric charge. So you get quite a bit out of one of these things. Though it, oh, there we go. It does have an internal attachment point there, as you can see, as we consume the inline cockpit there. And it is just simply a wonderful, wonderful piece of work here. I do very much like it. Again, lots of great details to it from the show. And yeah, just a fun little cargo pod with some good engines there. Now, the next one that we do have is the cargo pod. Now, this one only has a crew capacity up to 2 Kerbals, has that same built-in alternator, docking node, engines providing up to 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust with liquid fuel and oxidizer, the same 2 degrees of gimbling, the reaction wheel, SAS, and a 50 electric charge. The only main difference between this and the last pod was it doesn't have that command capability, but it is quite a bit larger and has quite a few more engines, which just look spectacular. I really do like this thing. It is quite cool. And of course, a nice little internal cargo section right there for you to use. And again, that same interior attachment node, and that it being the only one that it does have. Now, the next one that we do have is purely a cargo pod, which this one does still hold 2 Kerbals, has a built-in alternator, has the docking node, the 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust, gimbling of 2 degrees, reaction wheel, SAS, and 50 electric charge. This one, though, is, well, has a lot less other frills on the exterior, just having the large area for you to place your various bits of cargo upon. And it is just a nice little useful utilitarian thing. Now the next part that we have is the Eagle One Transporter Crane Pod. Once again, holding two Kerbals with an alternator, docking node, 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust, 2 degrees gimbling reaction wheel, SAS, 50 electric charge. And this one has, it's similar to the last pod we had, the cargo pod, but has this sort of winch-looking system on it, and also causes a tremendous amount of lag. I mean, you can probably notice as I move this thing around, it does not move smooth. And to give you an idea, normally I get quite a high FPS in here, at the very least 60. When I start moving this thing around, it goes down to 12. I don't know why, but for some reason, this part causes a huge amount of lag, and I would definitely not recommend putting it on any of your ships because, well, you'll be flying at an extremely low FPS, and that's not helpful, which is sad because it is just such a cool-looking part, but when it does move, oh boy, it ruins things. Now let's have a look at the last of the pods here, the Medical Science Pod, which can hold up to 8 Kerbals, has that alternator, docking node, 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust, 2 degrees gimbling reaction wheel, SAS, and 50 electric charge. And this one is the largest and most impressive of them all, and just looks good. It's, I mean, basically the basic pod with some little extension bits over there with some nice RCS on it. Though it doesn't actually have the RCS, as you can see by the stats that we just went through. So, sadly, those don't actually work. They're purely there for aesthetics, but you can always kind of make them work later when we get to another part. But yes, all in all, another good part with that internal attachment node, and no frame drops with this one. Now let's head down to the next category, which is engines, where we have a 5 to choose from. The first being the Eagle One Transporter Nuclear Engines. And these things, oh boy, will produce 3,100 kilonewtons of thrust. They do have a built-in alternator, have 2 degrees of gimbling, and use liquid fuel and oxidizer. And all in all, they are some pretty large and impressive engines there, if we could actually get to the attachment point. Why are you not cooperating? There we go. Excellent. We have the engines on there. A lot of great detail to these things. I love all the piping all over it. It's just a good looking thing and super powerful, so always fun for various missions. Now, the next one we do have here is the Nuclear Engine Heavy Atmosphere Engines. Now, this goes along. I actually don't know if we can attach. Oh, we can. Right in there. Oh, well. Got it. Perfect. Now, this one will provide, again, 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust, like with the pods, has the alternator, the 2 degrees of gimbling, using liquid fuel and oxidizer, and add in this very cool large support frame, and it goes quite nicely with the Eagle One to sort of add some more engines out to the edges of it, and just look cool. I love the more industrial vibe to it. I mean, that's a big reason I like Space 1999 in general, and it's just a nice little set of vertical takeoff and landing engines. Now, then, we have the Nuclear Engine Overdrive Unit, which will provide another 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust with liquid fuel and oxidizer, 2 degrees of gimbling, and the alternator. You're probably sensing a bit of copy and paste with a lot of these stats, but, I mean, hey, they still look cool. And if we pop this one on here and try and find a place where it'll pop in, I'm not having luck with it. Oh, there we go. We got it. Perfect. Even holding Alt, it did not want to cooperate. And there we are. Just another cool, fun-looking engine. Again, lots of great detailing to this thing that I absolutely love. The texturing's very well done. All the piping and tanks on here is quite cool-looking. Just all in all, another fun engine. Now, the next one that we do have is the Hawk Interceptor Nuclear Engine, providing once more 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust with liquid fuel and oxidizer, 2 degrees of gimbling, and an alternator providing electric charge. And this one, if we pop onto here, again, the attachment nodes, when trying to attach it to something that's not a Hawk Interceptor, are a bit finicky, but there we go. As you can see, my mouse was kind of over here, even though the attachment point looks like it's on the back of the engine. It's actually kind of a little bit in front of it, which is awkward. But again, another cool looking engine here that provides you a good amount of thrust. Now the next one we have is the Hawk Interceptor side nuclear engines, once more providing 2,500 kilonewtons of thrust with liquid fuel and oxidizer, 2 degrees of gimbling, alternator producing electric charge, but we also do have on this one RCS thrusters with a thruster power of 89, using of course monopropellant. And if we pop these babies onto there, that one went on much more nicely. And yeah, just some cool nacelles going off of the side of the ship. A very good looking, the usable RCS there on the side. Just a fun engine. And if we pop this thing off and then head down to command and control, we have the Eagle 5 channel RCS thruster. There we go. I lost my words there for a little second. And this one has a thruster power of 1.25 using monopropellant. And if we pop it on to the side here, it is, well, I mean, an RCS port. So there you go. You can place it on there and have some fun. And of course, could be used to kind of try and glitch it into the side of the Eagle 1 crew pods to make the one on the medical science one especially perhaps actually functional if you kind of clip it in there a bit. But overall, just a good solid RCS. Now, after that, we have two things in structural, which, oh boy, are gigantic. The first of them is the Eagle 1 landing platform, which is an actual giant landing platform for this thing, and it's pretty great. Now, it looks awesome visually here, but you don't want to land on it. I'll show you why when we do get outside, but if you land a ship on it, your ship immediately breaks, no matter what. No matter how safely you land on this thing, your ship will break. Again, I'll show you that when we get outside in a second, but all in all, it's just a cool freaking thing. No stats to speak of for this particular landing platform, but it's awesome. Now, we also do have another one of these, of course, and that is the Eagle 1 Repair and Maintenance Bay, which, again, is just friggin' ginormous. We're actually gonna have to move the camera around here. I wish I would have installed the mod that lets you go outside the hangar, but forgot to. And yeah, it's just a large repair hangar. Now, these, of course, do, like with all the other parts, match Space 1999. And again, though, you don't want to land on it. It looks cool, put it out in the world aesthetically, but don't touch it, your ship will break. Now, let's pop ourselves there and kind of get ourselves kind of back in the right location. There we are. And we have nothing in robotics, nothing in coupling, nothing in payload, but in aerodynamics, we do have the Eagle 1 transporter docking clamp, which is a just simple docking clamp. If we actually zoom in, we can't even actually zoom in far enough because this is quite a small little part that also doesn't help that it went all the way back there in the world. Let's pop that off again and see if we can get it closer. We cannot. Oh boy, the camera really went wibbly wobbly on this one. And yeah, it's basically just four little rectangles, which you probably saw a second ago in the clips that I put out there. And it, well, is a helpful docking port for the Eagle 1 transporter. Now, after that, we have nothing in ground, nor thermal, nor electrical, nor communication, science, or cargo, but in utility, we have the final two parts, and these are the main body fuselage sections of the two main ships. So, of course, here we have the Eagle 1 transporter fuselage, which is glorious. Oh, I love this thing. It just looks so darn good. I love the design of this. Again, that more industrial feel that Space 1999 had. It's just awesome. And now, as for the stats on this thing, it does actually have a crew capacity of a 1 with a built-in alternator, as well as a data transmitter, docking node, an engine providing 3,100 kilonewtons of thrust with liquid fuel and oxidizer, a generator providing all of the things. It's kind of cheaty in that way, but I mean, hey, it's a sci-fi ship, so what do you expect? Gimbling of 2 degrees, built-in RCS with 89 thruster power, 500 electric charge max, and then liquid fuel of 5,000, monopropellant of 5,000, and oxidizer of 5,000. All in all, a pretty cool part, again, with all the generators providing all of the resources. A little cheaty, but I'm cool with it to have it in here. Now, then after that, we of course have the Hawk 1 Interceptor fuselage, and this one, again, will hold a single crew member, has the alternator. This one, again, with the data transmitter, only 2,900 kilonewtons of thrust on this one with liquid fuel and oxidizer, the various resource generators, the gimbaling reaction wheel, a 500 electric charge, 5,000 liquid fuel, 500 monopropellant, and 5,000 oxidizer. And if we pop it on there, again, glorious looking. Love the detailing on all of the modeling. It's just a fun, cool ship. Now, let's actually head out into the world with... let's actually load up one of the ships that I made earlier. I made several, but let's grab the Eagle One Medical in all of its glory. Of course, we have the main cockpit there, the fuselage, then the heavy atmospheric unit engines, the medical science pod, a variety of cool other engines on here, and just all in all, a fun craft. And let's take it out to the launch pad and then also briefly look at some other things I put out here and show you how your ships break if you try and land on those. We'll actually come back to this ship here in a second. Let's go over here to the Eagle One repair bay, and as you can see, I tried to actually land an Eagle One on top of this thing. It stopped there. It couldn't go any lower, and immediately once it stopped there, the cockpit, as you can see, decapitated itself and fell ever so slightly lower. I don't know why, but yeah, don't actually try and land on the landing bay. Again, a cool aesthetic part, and if you have some of the construction mods, it'd be cool to build up on the moon. But yeah, don't try and land on it. We then also have the landing platform where there used to be a Hawk Interceptor here. All that's left is the cockpit there. It also decapitated itself. I have no idea where the rest of the thing went. It did used to have a fuselage lying there as well. It seems to have maybe clipped into the world. But yeah, don't land on this either. It will break your ship. But back to the actual functioning... Oh, wait. There we go. Functioning ship. let us activate these engines. Turn on our SAS. We'll go ahead and activate these engines as well. And we have a beautiful takeoff system for a VTOL. Always fun to have ships like this. And again, I was a big fan of Space 1999. So having these ships in the game for any purpose is pretty cool. And even though the landing bays don't work, there's still fun additions to have into the game here. And I have had a huge amount of fun with them. Because, I mean, how could you not? They're just so cool. And I've already run out of fuel because I, of course, forgot to turn on the super cheaty generators. Let's turn those on so that we have things again so we can actually create fuel, because that's a great thing to do. Oh boy, I don't have enough control though with the low fuel. Let's just power up and wait for it to crash because I forgot to turn off the other engines and it's tumbling to its doom. Good times. But as you can see, very strong. Our Kerbals will live. Our Kerbals did not live. God, I love this game. But yes, that is the Kerry Anderson's Space 1999 pack. If you'd like to have a look at it for yourself, which I would certainly recommend you go and do, you can have a look at the link in the description as per usual. But yeah, that is gonna be it for today. I hope you all have enjoyed and that you do come back for the next episode when hopefully we'll be looking at another wonderful mod. But until that time, thank you for watching. And as always, have a good one!